The Quarkus project enables you to develop Kubernetes-native applications based on Java and a huge list of well-established Java-based frameworks. Hibernate is, of course, one of these frameworks. But the project not only enables you to build native applications with incredibly fast boot times and a very small memory footprint, it also provides a bunch of usability features that make our job as developers easier. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen with the first video of my new series about building persistence layers for Quarkus-based applications. But before we proceed, if you're new here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredibly efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and Spring, and all types of other Java persistence-related stuff, subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. In this first video of the series, we will focus on using plain Hibernate with Quarkus. There is no huge difference compared to using Hibernate in a standard Java SE or Jakarta EE application. But there are a few things you need to know, like why you need to use compatible versions of your preferred frameworks and how to use the centralized configuration. In future videos of this series, I will show you Panache. It's a Quarkus-specific framework that sits on top of Hibernate. Makes implementing your persistence layer a lot easier by applying the active record or the repository pattern. But let's start by using plain Hibernate in a Quarkus application. Before you can start implementing your domain model, you need to create an application and add the required dependencies. The easiest way to do that is to use the interactive project generator at code.quarkus.io. It enables you to specify the metadata of your project and pick the required dependencies. If you want to use Hibernate, make sure to select Hibernate ORM and the JDBC driver of your preferred database. Based on this information, it then generates a project and provides it as a downloadable archive. If you prefer setting up the project yourself, please follow the guides at quarkus.io and add a Quarkus-specific dependency to Hibernate and your JDBC driver to your project. To achieve the goals of Quarkus, support GraalVM as one of its runtimes, and support the creation of native images, the team had to impose some technical constraints on the libraries and frameworks you can use with it. Quite often, this makes it impossible to use the standard version of these frameworks. But don't worry, a long list of the most popular Java frameworks already offer compatible versions, and you only need to reference the right artifact. After you created your project and added the required dependencies, it's time to configure Hibernate. This takes significantly less effort than for Java SE or Jakarta EE applications. You don't need to create a persistence.xml file and copy several lines of standard configuration from an existing project. Quarkus generates that for you based on the dependencies you added to your project and a set of smart defaults. But there are still a few things you need to configure, like the connection to your database, if Hibernate shall generate the database schema, and the logging of your application. You can configure all of this in the application.properties file. This example here uses Postgres as the username and password when connecting to the database test on localhost at port 5432. It also tells Hibernate to drop and create the database based on entity mappings and import the data.sql script. Let's quickly summarize the most important configuration properties. You can find a complete list in the Quarkus documentation. Quarkus.datasource.username and Quarkus.datasource.password. These are the username and password that Quarkus shall use to connect to your database. Quarkus.datasource.jdbc.url sets the JDBC URL that Quarkus shall use to connect to your database. Hibernate will automatically pick a matching dialect, but requires a matching JDBC driver at runtime. Quarkus.hibernate.orm.database.defaultschema defines the default database schema to which Hibernate shall map the database objects. Quarkus.hibernate-orm.physical-naming-strategy and Quarkus.hibernate-orm.implicit-naming-strategy configure the naming strategies that Quarkus shall use to map your entity classes and properties to the database tables and columns. Quarkus.hibernate-orm.second-level-caching enabled activates or deactivates Hibernate second-level cache. It's activated by default, and you only need to activate caching in your entity mapping. Quarkus.hibernate-orm.statistics and Quarkus.hibernate-orm.metrics.enabled Define if Hibernate's statistics component is activated and if they are published using a metrics extension. It's deactivated by default. Quarkus.hibernateorm.log.sql and Quarkus.hibernateorm.log.formatsql and Quarkus.hibernateorm.log.bindparameters configure if Hibernate shall log SQA statements, format them, and include bindparameter values. Okay, let's get into the IDE and give it a try. You define your entities in the same way as for any other Hibernate-based application. For a basic default mapping, you implement a Java class with the same name as your database table, add a default constructor, and annotate it with entity. And for each database column you want to map, you add a private attribute with the same name. To comply with the JPA specification, you should also provide a getter and setter method for each attribute. Here you can see an example of a chess player entity that Hibernate maps to the chess player table. The ID attribute maps the primary key column, and Hibernate uses the database sequence player_sec to generate unique primary key values. The attributes first name, last name, and birth date get mapped to columns with the same name. And Hibernate uses the version attribute to prevent concurrent modifications by applying the optimistic locking algorithm. I expect you to be familiar with JPAs and Hibernate's basic mappings and query features for this video. If that's not the case, I recommend reading some of my beginner articles on torbenjansen.com or joining my JPA for Beginners online course. In this video, we are using plain Hibernate, so it shouldn't be a surprise if I tell you that you can use it in the same way as in any other Jakarta EE application. This will change when we use Panache in future videos of this series. The easiest way to get an Entity Manager instance is to inject it using the inject annotation. This is the same approach as you are probably already using in your Jakarta EE applications. You can then use this Entity Manager to read entities or DTOs using JPQL, native, or criteria queries in your business code. As usual, all entity objects you load from the database, or for which you call the persist method, are in the lifecycle state managed. Hibernate will include them in its dirty checks and automatically flush all changes to the database. You can use Hibernate with Quarkus in almost the same way as in a Java SE or Jakarta EE application. The only differences are the required dependencies and the configuration of your application. Quarkus can use GraalVM as a runtime, which introduces some technical limitations on the code that will be executed. This provides almost no limitations to the code you write yourself, but it made many Java frameworks unusable. Fortunately, a long list of the most popular Java frameworks has been adjusted to work in this environment. Please make sure to always reference these versions in your dependencies. This is automatically the case if you create your project using code.quarkus.io. By default, Quarkus provides most of Hibernate's configuration based on smart defaults and the dependencies available on the class path. You can adjust all defaults and add your own configuration parameters to the application.properties file. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join my free member library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content like cheat sheets, ebooks, and a free video course. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!